My dear students, welcome to all of you. The topic of my today's lecture is general characters of angiosperms. First, I would like to give you the introduction of the topic. The angiosperms are the flowering plants. The group is also known as angiospermy or Magnoliophyta. It is the most diverse group of land plants. Angiosperms are the seed producing plants like the gymnosperms and can be distinguished from the gymnosperms by a series of synapomorphies. These synapomorphies are actually the derived characters. These characteristics include flowers, endosperm within the seeds, and the production of fruits that contain the seeds. Angiosperms represent the most advanced group of plants. The plant body consists of underground root system and an aerial shoot system. The shoot system contains vegetative parts and the reproductive parts. The root serves two primary functions, that is anchoring and absorption. Roots may show some modifications for performing specific functions. These modifications may be storage of food or for providing mechanical support or for the other vital functions. The main axis of the shoot system is called as stem. It is ascending portion of the plant body and bears distinct nodes and internodes. Branches, leaves and buds may also arise at the nodal regions. Stem may be erect and strong or may be weak, prostrate, decumbent, creeping, twining or climbing type. Now we will discuss its habitat and distribution. The angiosperms are the principal components of nearly all the land habitats. Angiosperms comprise about 90% of the kingdom plantae. The total number of described species exceeds 250,000 and many tropical species are as yet unnamed. During the past 130 million years, flowering plants have colonized practically every conceivable habitat on the earth. From deserts and alpine summits to fertile grasslands, fresh and marine waters, the three largest and widely distributed flowering families containing the greatest number of species are the sunflower family, that is Asteraceae, with about 23,000 species, followed by orchid family, Orchidaceae, with about 19,500 species, and the legume or pea family, Fabaceae, with 18,000 species. The total number of species of all the three enormous families alone is approximately 62,000, that is roughly 25% of all the flowering plant species on earth. Now we will see its morphology. The main plant body of angiosperm is a sporophyte. It is differentiated clearly into two regions. The ascending portion of the plant body is called a shoot system and the descending portion is called a root system. The shoot system has an axis that is called stem, which is differentiated into nodes and internodes. At the nodes, little appendages called leaves arise. The leaves are green in color. Also seen at the nodes are structures called branches and flowers. The branches also produce leaves and flowers. Flowers are the reproductive structures. The tip of the stem usually has a terminal bud, which brings about the linear growth. In the axil of the leaf, at the angle between the leaf and the stem, there is an axillary bud, which brings about the formation of a branch or an inflorescence or a flower. There are two kinds of functional structures in an angiosperm plant body, namely the vegetative parts and the reproductive parts. The root, stem, branch and the leaves represent the vegetative part of the plant, whereas the flowers represent the reproductive part. Now we will see these parts one by one. Number one, root system. Root is the descending portion of the axis of the plant. It is not normally green in color. It is characterized by the absence of nodes and internodes. And there are two types of root systems: the taproot system, as seen in dicots, and fibrous root system, as seen in monocots. In taproot system, the radical elongates into the primary root, which grows downwards into the soil and bears smaller roots as its branch. In adventitious root system, the roots develop from any part of the plant body other than the radical are called adventitious roots. They may arise from the leaves as in bryophyllum, from the branches as in banyan, or from the basal nodes as in case of monocots. Now, as per the structure of the root is concerned, it consists of the following regions. From the apex upwards, the root cap is a protective part, consists of dead cells, lies at the apex just behind the root cap, there is a meristematic zone in which the cells are in a state of active division. Now, shoot system. Shoot is the ascending portion of the axis and develops from the plumule of the embryo. It consists of main axis or stem, branches and leaves. The stem is provided with nodes and internodes, which may not be distinct in all the cases. Leaves and branches develop from the nodes. The portion between the two successive nodes is called an internode. Angiosperm possesses diverse forms or modifications. Some common modifications are as under. Trailers. These are the plants with a weak stem trailing on the ground without rooting at the nodes. They may be classified into prostate, procumbent or decumbent trailers. Number next is creeper. Here the stem is weak and creeps on the surface of the soil. The creeping stem produces roots at the nodal region, for example oxalis. In case of climbers, the plants climb on the neighboring objects with some special devices, for example pea. Now branching system. The pattern of development of branches on the stem is known as branching. There are two types of branchings, namely lateral and dichotomous branching. In lateral branching, the branch arises from the side of the stem. It is divided into two types, racemose or monopodial or indefinite type of branching and cymose or definite type of branching. In racemose type of branching, the stem grows indefinitely by the continuous growth of the terminal bud. The lateral branches of the main stem are arranged in an acropetal succession, that is, the younger branches are produced toward the apex and the older ones toward the base. As a result of this branching, the plant appears conical or pyramidal shape, for example, Casuarina, Polyalthea, etc. In cymose type of branching, the growth of the main axis is definite. The lateral branches grow more vigorously than the main axis. As a result of this branching, the plant spreads out above and becomes more or less dome shaped. Now, dichotomous branching. Here, two branches are produced in a forked manner at each node in comparison to a single branch, as in case of lateral type of branching. Now, we will see the morphology of leaf. The leaves are green, flattened structure borne on the nodes and is later appendage of the stem. A typical leaf is also known as a foliage leaf in order to distinguish it from other types of leaves. A typical dicot leaf, for example in hibiscus, consists of the following parts, namely leaf base, petiole and lamina. Now we will discuss these parts of the leaves one by one. The leaf base is the portion by which the leaf is attached to the stem. In monocots, the leaf base is of sheathing type. In case of dicots, the leaf base could bear two lateral outgrowths called stipules. Now, petiole, it is the stalk of the leaf. A leaf with a petiole is described as petiolate leaf, for example, hibiscus. A leaf without a petiole is called sessile, for example, calotropes. Leaf blade or lamina, it forms the green expanded portion of the leaf. In the dicot leaf, the lamina has a central midrib running from the base to the apex. The lamina on either side produces veins, which in turn produces veinlets to form a network of veins. Hence, the venation is described as reticulate type. The edge of the lamina is called the leaf margin, which may be entire or smooth or variously cut and lobed. In case of monocots, the leaves are upright and almost linear, with parallel venation. Both the sides are equally exposed to sunlight, that means the leaves are isobilateral, for example, Siamese. Dear students, now we will see the anatomy of these flowering plants, that is angiosperms. Anatomy or phylotomy is the general term for the study of internal structures of the plant. While originally it includes plant morphology, since the mid-20th century, the investigations of the plant anatomy are considered a separate, distinct field, and the plant anatomy refers to just the internal plant structures. Plant anatomy is now frequently investigated at the cellular level and often involves the sectioning of tissue and microscopy. The anatomy of various plant parts are discussed as angiospermic stem. In angiospermic stem, the branches of vascular tissue separating the xylem and phloem are arranged in organized layers. In monocots, the vesicular bundles are scattered throughout the stem across sections, whereas the vesicular bundles in dicots are arranged in a ring. The phloem cells are thin-walled and are found outside the vesicular bundles, while the xylem cells are found on the inner side. Additional stem tissues are the pith, cortex, and the covering layer, that is epidermis. Now we will see the anatomy of the angiospermic root. Like the stem, the root has an epidermis, cortex, phloem, and the xylem cells. The epidermis contains the root hairs here. The root hairs are specialized cells of the root epidermis with thin-walled projections. They provide the increased surface area for absorption of water and minerals from the soil through diffusion and active transport. The main functions of the roots are absorption, which is accomplished through the root hairs. The root also provides anchorage of the plant with the ground. Some of the roots have additional function of storage of food, like roots of turnip and carrots. Now, anatomy of leaf. Leaves are the plant organs which perform the function of photosynthesis. The angiospermic leaves have a waxy cuticle on the surface that prevents excessive loss of water. The upper epidermis, that is the top layer, of the leaf, generally does not have any stomatal opening. This is the adaptation to inhibit excessive transpiration so as to conserve the loss of water. Another photosynthetic adaptation is the palisade mesophyll layer, which is spread over a large surface area of the leaf. It contains chloroplasts and are directly under the upper epidermis so that they are well exposed to sunlight. The leaves also have spongy mesophyll toward the lower surface, which contains the air spaces into which opens the stomata. Now we will see the reproduction of angiosperms. First, we will discuss the definition of reproduction. It is the creation of life by similar life is called reproduction. Reproduction is the extension of life of a species at a given time. By this process, the individuals transmit life to the next generation and thereby ensure the continued existence of living organisms on the earth. If there would have been no reproduction, life on the earth would sooner come to an end. The angiosperms reproduce by several methods. They are broadly grouped into two types: asexual or vegetative reproduction and sexual reproduction. In case of asexual reproduction, new individuals are produced from a single parent without the act of fusion of gametes. The new individuals so formed are generally identical to the parent plant, as only mitotic divisions takes place during the development. Regeneration of the new plants from portion of the vegetative organs is very common and is called a vegetative propagation. For this purpose, organs like the roots, stem and leaves, flowers, etc. are variously modified to produce the new ones. The method of vegetative propagation can be classified into two types: natural vegetative propagation and number two, artificial vegetative propagation. In natural vegetative propagation, a part of the plant, which may be stem or root, leaf or flower, gets detached from the body of the mother plant. The detached part, under suitable environmental conditions, develop into the new independent plant. The common structures that take part in the natural vegetative propagation are roots, stem, leaves and buds. Now, artificial vegetative propagation. Certain flowering plants have the capacity to develop a part of their somatic body into the new independent plant. In artificial vegetative propagation, such plants are identified as special techniques as are applied to obtain new independent plants. Horticulturists have used the various methods of vegetative propagation adopted by plants in nature. These practices constitute the artificial means of vegetative propagation. Some common and important methods of artificial vegetative propagation are as under. Number one, cutting. It is the process in which a vegetative portion from a plant is taken and is rooted in the soil to form a new plant. The portion used is called a cutting. Next is layering. In this technique, roots are induced on a stem before it is detached from the plant body. In the layering, the lower branch close to the ground is bent down and covered with the soil. After some days, roots develop from these branches, and these branches then can be cut and grown independently in the new plants. Next method is grafting. It is the process of joining together parts of two different plants of closely related varieties in such a manner that they live as a single plant. This is usually practiced among dicotyledonous plants, especially fruit trees. Of the two plants, one is rooted in the soil, is known as stalk. The other part, being grafted over, is known as shoot. Next method is guti. In this method, a healthy and a woody branch is selected, and the bark is sliced out. A thick plaster of grafting clay is wrapped around the sliced ring. The plaster is formed of clay, cow dung, finely cut hay, and water. Care is taken to keep the guti moist. In about 2 to 3 months, the roots emerge from the guti. The guti is now cut below the plaster for propagation. Examples are lemon, orange, guava, and lychee. These are usually propagated by using this method. Next method of propagation, very important method of propagation, is micropropagation or propagation by tissue culture technique. In micropropagation, a small amount of tissue from a suitable part of the plant is excised and grown on a nutrient medium under aseptic conditions. The tissue then develops into an undifferentiated mass of cells called callus. A small portion of the callus tissue is transferred to another suitable nutrient medium where they develop and differentiate into small plantlets. These plantlets, on being transplanted, develop into the new plants. Now, dear students, we will discuss the sexual reproduction, especially the sexual reproduction in case of angiosperms. Sexual reproduction is the formation of new individual following the union of two gametes. In plants, the gametes are eggs and sperms, and the structures that produce these gametes are located within the flower. Flowers are the reproductive structures, consist of sterile and fertile parts. Sterile parts of the flower are the sepals and petals. When these are similar in size and shape, they are termed as tepals. Fertile and reproductive parts of the flower are the stamens and carpels. Stamens constitute the male reproductive part, collectively termed as androecium. Each stamen possesses a long filament and an anther which contains the pollen grains. The female reproductive organs are called carpels, collectively termed as gynoecium. Each carpel consists of upper stigma, middle stalk, and a lower swollen ovary. Now, we will see the pollination. Pollination is actually the transfer of pollen from anther to stigma. Many plants favor cross-pollination. So, pollen of one plant must be transferred to the stigma of another plant if sexual reproduction is to take place. Some flowers rely on the wind to carry pollen grains, while others rely on insects. In self-pollination, pollen is transferred from anther to stigma of the same flower or another flower but of the same plant. Now, fertilization. If the pollen grains land on a compatible stigma, a pollen tube will go so that eventually the egg cell hidden away from the embryo sac can be fertilized. A tube emerges from the grain. It is growth being controlled by the tube nucleus at the tip of the tube. It may grow downwards in a response to the chemicals made by the ovary. This response is known as chemotropism. During the growth and extension of the tube, the generating nucleus behind the tube nucleus divides the mitosis to produce two male gametes. The pollen tube enters the ovule through micropyle and penetrates the embryo sac. The tip of the pollen tube bursts open. One male gamete fuses with the egg cell to produce a diploid zygote, and the other one with secondary diploid polar nucleus to form the triploid primary endosperm nucleus. This way, double fertilization occurs in angiosperms. Immediately after fertilization, the ovule is known as seed. Now we will see germination. When the conditions are favorable, the seeds will take up water through the micropyle by imbibition. This triggers the beginning of the growth of the seed. The cell swells and the testa splits. With the addition of water, large molecules of carbohydrates, proteins and fats can be hydrolyzed, broken down to produce substances for respiration. The growing embryo releases a hormone called gibberellic acid, and some enzymes are produced and released in response to this hormone. The soluble products of digestion are delivered to the cotyledons, roots and shoots. They respire aerobically and grow in size. By the time the food store has been used up, the shoots are now grown enough to push the first leaves into the sunlight, which then starts food manufacturing by photosynthesis. Dear students, this way we have completed our today's topic, which was the characters of angiosperms, and I think all of the parameters have well been discussed, and I think all of you would have liked it and understood and well understood it. Thank you.